A very good evening to one and all. I welcome you all to the PG Examination Forum, the SSTC webinar on Visual Fields A to Z, Session 1. The PG Examination Forum is a great platform for the young and budding ophthalmologists across the country to have a one-to-one interaction with eminent speakers from all subspecialties in ophthalmology. Today, we have with us a galaxy of such role models, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce the chairperson for today, Dr. Barun Kumar Nayak. Dr. B.K. Nayak is the president-elect of the All India Ophthalmologist Society. He is the head of the PD Hinduja Hospital, Mumbai. He is also the secretary of the Glaucoma Society of India and the vice president of the Maharashtra Ophthalmological Society. I welcome you, sir. To shed light on the difficult and often confusing topics of visual field interpretation, we have with us as a speaker the well-renowned Dr. G.R. Reddy. Dr. G.R. Reddy is the director of G.R. Reddy Eye Care Center, Tadepalli Gudem, West Godavari District, Andhra Pradesh. Dr. Reddy completed his MS in ophthalmology from PGI Chandigarh, and he is the author of the well-renowned book, Practical Guide to Interpret Visual Fields. Welcome, sir. And now, without further ado, I'd like to introduce the heart and soul of the SSTC PG Webinar Forum, our moderators for the evening, Dr. Deepak Mishra, sir, and Dr. Satanshu Mathur, sir. Dr. Deepak Mishra is the faculty at the Regional Institute of Ophthalmology, VHU Varanasi. He is the founder and administrator of the PG Examination Forum and the chairman of the scientific committee, UPSOS. He is also the national convener of the SSTC. Dr. Satanshu Mathur, sir, is the chairman of scientific committee, ACOIN, the national convener at SSTC. He is the secretary, NZOS, UKSOS, and he owns the High-Tech Eye Institute and Laser Center, Kashipur, Uttarakhand. Over to you, Dr. Deepak Mishra, sir, and Dr. Satanshu Mathur, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Meet, for your kind introduction. Kindly stop sharing your PPT. Now I invite our chairperson, Professor V.K. Nayak, sir, to say a few words about the meeting.
Thank you, Dr. Deepak Mishra, and thank you, Dr. Meet, for introducing. I am really thankful. I'm so happy that this forum is really very active and is really helping the budding ophthalmologists of the country. So it's really great job, Deepak and Dr. Mathur, you two are doing on this forum. And so today's speaker, as you know, Dr. G.R. Reddy, means his, whenever he talks on perimetry, his heart and soul, you will realize that he is just talking from his heart and soul. He's fully involved in it. And nothing, he goes to the basics and means nothing artificial. Everything, whatever he will talk will be practical and it will be really useful. So I will really, I'll urge all the students that listen to him very, very carefully and just try to grasp whatever. And he's a very good orator. So I have no doubt that you all will be benefited. And just for this thing, means in the beginning, I will just tell you something about general aspect of this perimetry before Dr. Reddy will come. So can you see my share? Can you see my screen? Is it visible? Is it visible, Deepak?
Yes, sir. Now it is visible.
Okay. So just I will take about 5 minutes in the beginning to give you some general, it's understanding and some general guideline, which probably some useful trip, which will be always useful. And just so I'll be very, very slow, whatever I'm talking for 5 to 7 minutes, which will be really and you cannot ignore even a single fact which I am going to tell. Say usage of perimetry, it is very useful in glaucoma, and without perimetry, glaucoma practice and management cannot, you cannot imagine, you cannot do glaucoma practice without involving perimetry in your management. So glaucoma is very, and especially after the introduction of automated perimetry, the use of this has really soared like anything, because when we were student, PG students that time, we were doing all this perimetry manual on BRM screen. Then you can imagine how difficult was this for the person who is doing this perimetry. But now it's all automated, so it has made some life simple for the person who is doing it, but very difficult for the patients, because it's not easy thing to do perimetry for the patient. They don't like this test. The second is neurological disease, because in the era of MRI, CT scan and such advanced imaging technologies, still perimetry has its place in neurological diseases also. And because there are two reasons. One is, whenever a patient of with neurological problems, because ophthalmic presentation is a major aspect in neurological problem. So sometimes patient will land up with ophthalmologist first. So you have to do perimetry on that basis, and history and of course examination, you will know that, okay, this is a neurological condition and I have to refer this patient to the suitable place if it's required surgery, to neurosurgery or neurophysician, as the case may be. In retinal diseases also, this is important. And classifying visual disability, because one of the definition of blindness or visual disability is also the criteria of perimetry. So perimetry is important. So don't think that perimetry is only important for glaucoma. It's for other things also. In glaucoma, it is used for two purposes. One is for diagnosis. And second is, once it has been diagnosed glaucoma, you have started treatment, then how the patient is behaving with the treatment, that you will again, you will be judging with the progress of the condition with the perimetry. So you have, so twofold purpose perimetry serves. Now, whenever a glaucoma patient comes for, because glaucoma, you know, it's a, once the glaucoma patient is lifetime, a patient for the lifetime, he will be patient of your patient, and regular follow-up is necessary. Every time when patient comes, you will be checking intraocular pressure apart from the regular examination. Disc, you will be checking optic disc evaluation and perimetry, not every visit, but less frequently, but you will be doing perimetry. The purpose of doing this test is two entirely different things that you have to understand in glaucoma patients. Intraocular pressure is basically to know the efficacy, or judging the efficacy of your intervention, whether it is medical intervention, surgical intervention, or laser treatment. But whether this pressure reduction, whatever you have achieved, is sufficient or not, that you will come to know only by disc evaluation and perimetry. So suppose intraocular pressure, so you have given one some medicine and it has produced desired result, you are very happy, but still if perimetrically, if it is progressing, it means this drop is not sufficient. You have to do something more to bring down further. So that's why perimetry has got role in glaucoma management throughout the course of the disease. Also remember, OCT cannot replace perimetry in glaucoma management. So sometimes people get carried away that I have OCT and I have done OCT and perimetry, we can bypass perimetry. No, in glaucoma, without perimetry, you cannot practice glaucoma, but without OCT, yes, you can. So then you will realize the importance of the perimetry, that OCT cannot replace perimetry. Again, I am repeating, cannot replace perimetry. Now, whenever you are reading a printout, don't be in hurry. Any printout, forget about perimetry printout, any printout in ophthalmic evaluation, always follow this sequence. GRADES, which goes by mnemonics, GRADES. G stands for general information. First, look into that perimetry printout. Whatever printout you will be seeing, nothing is superfluous. Nothing is printed just because the company wanted that, oh, it should look good. That's why I'm putting it. Everything has a purpose, which Dr. Reddy will be all explaining in detail. So general information, then go to the next stage, whether it is reliable response of the patient or not. You have not done perimetry yourself. So the just by looking at the report and certain data over there, which is printed, you will come to know, yes, this report is reliable. I should analyze this and proceed further. Next is A, which is this field is abnormal or normal. If it is normal, that matter ends there. Then you proceed further, means with the patients, correlate clinically and proceed further. If it is abnormal, then try to find out D, what defect it is. What defect means that there are so many defects, whether altitudinal defect, whether it's a localized defect in the nerve fiber layer area, nerve fiber bundle defect, or it is hemianopic defect, or it is isolated scotoma, which is maybe central, maybe centrosecal, because all defect as or it is arcuate defect or nasal step. So all this you try to classify what are the abnormal thing I am seeing in this particular patient and other indices which you will be seeing. So that Dr. Reddy will again tell you. So defect, try to classify that defect, which defect this is I can name or fall into. Then go to E, is evaluate, is clinically correlate. Just perimetry defect will not give you diagnosis, or any defect in any other test also will not give you diagnosis. You have to correlate clinically, evaluate with the patient which is sitting in front of you, whose test has been done. And so that is GRADE. And S, in repeat test, means subsequent test, you have to see, you have to find out what is happening, whether the field is remaining stable or it is progressing or improving. So that is the, always go by that sequence, never bypass that. And also please note that perimetry, there is a lot of variation. If I do perimetry myself today, I do it 5 days later, there will be not the same defect I will get, not the same finding, exactly same finding. There will be some variation, because there is something which is the patient factor which matters. Also, there is a known thing about this fluctuation, short-term fluctuation, long-term fluctuation. So whatever numbers you are getting is not that always you will get the same. So when you are analyzing, reanalyzing repeat tests, you should keep this fact in mind. Then see about the reliability parameters, then properly interpret. Proper interpretation is required. Then whenever glaucoma patients you are managing, the perimetry should be done on the same make of machine, not only same make of machine, at the same place and same machine. Because that machine, why I am talking about same machine, this machine will have all the previous data of this particular patient. So you can compare based on that what is the progress of this patient's perimetry. Then please do not keep one track mind. I have seen most of the ophthalmic doctors, whenever they start seeing patients, any defect, they think, oh, just this patient is having glaucoma. And if pressure is 25, definitely this defect is glaucomatous. No. So don't keep one track mind. Always try to differentiate between glaucomatous and neurological field defects. Like, say, whenever if you get a hemianopic defect, it cannot be a glaucomatous defect. It has to be neurological, somewhere in the visual pathway, in chiasma and beyond. So those facts you keep in mind. Correlate clinically, just because similar field may be having two different causative disease. Keep clinically, repeat the test in case of bizarre field defect. Something you get, something which you cannot say, it doesn't fit in your known entity or field defect. It means you are either, if you are very genius enough, you can discover some new field effect. But before doing that, you have to repeat the test. And many times you will see the second test is entirely different. The first may not be proper, because there is always a learning curve in this field, computerized perimetry. and take care of all the fallacies, which again Dr. Reddy will be talking in detail. And the last slide is, it's not an easy test to perform by patient. Patients are never happy. They are always very uncomfortable. So motivate the patient by explaining the importance of the test, that why this is important. So if he understands, he will always cooperate. Please give clear instruction to the patient before conducting the test. Because if you give clear instruction and explain properly what is expected from the patient, you will be, most of the time you will get a good response and reliable response from the patient, which will be repeatable. If the first field is showing defect, always reconfirm by repeat testing. Because you see, the patient's field, first time you have done field, if it is reliable, normal, you can take it as normal. If it is showing some defect, you must repeat this test, may not be same day, means based on the severity of the condition and urgency of the matter, repeat it. So if the two fields are similar, then you can say that, okay, this is the real field, actual field of this particular patient, but second field is something different. Again, repeat after some time, unless you get two fields which are corresponding. If any field is showing progression, same way, you have done say 5-6 tests. Now suddenly you see that, okay, now there is some progression, deterioration. Don't take it for granted unless you confirm by repeating the test. If the two subsequent tests show similar kind of deterioration, then only you take it as it's a real deterioration. Otherwise, because there are a lot of, as I said, variation and fluctuation. And get your own fields done to understand the difficulties of the patients. Unless you have get it done on your own eyes, you will not realize that how difficult for the patient to cooperate for this test. And also one point which I forgot to mention in the last slide, that the decibel value, you get the decibel value, the different, why I said same machine and same place it should be repeated and same make, because different make, the decibel value is not absolute value. Means all machines, say suppose the sensitivity of a particular point is 27 decibel in one machine and 27 decibel on some other machine, these 27 is not the same, not exactly the same value, not equivalent. So this difference you have to remember. That's why it should be always repeated on the same machine, so that you will know the actual progression of the disease. And anytime the maximum sensitivity of any human being, even in the center of the fovea, is, it cannot be more than 40 or at most 41. So sometimes you will see a response, patient responding 44, 45, 46 decibel. It means you can straight away reject this field. It is not proper, because even the center of fovea will have only 40 decibel. So these facts, if you keep in mind, always keep in mind, these are general facts. Apart from that, so I'm sure Dr. Reddy will also cover some of the facts, these things in his talk. Means most of the things will be covered. And he is a fantastic orator, I know. And as I said earlier, whatever he will talk, it is everything you can say, it's a golden word. So try to capture as much, collect as much gold as you can. So all best of the luck. And so Deepak, again, at the end, give me a call. I will be there during discussion in case if you want me.
Sure.
We always want you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Nayak, sir.
Yeah.
For giving, always giving your blessings to the PG Forum. And we are really indebted to you.
Thank you. Thank you. It's always students. Teaching is my passion.
Sir, it is an opportunity for the PG Forum students to listen you and Dr. Reddy together. And this, they should not miss any opportunity to ask any question and without any inhibition. Deepak, you can invite now Dr. Reddy, sir.
Reddy sir already shared his screen. We welcome you, sir. And it's our pleasure to have you at this forum. And I will not take any more time between you and your students. Sir, please start your presentation.
At the onset, thanks to Deepak and Mathur for inviting me for this to talk to the PGs. I'm very happy to talk with the PGs. And I'm very happy to see Nayak here. And perhaps you do not know that I am Ekalavya Shishya of Nayak. In late 90s, Mike used to speak about visual fields, and I used to sit and learn, and I still remember. Then I took the charge from early 20s. Mike, nice to see you. And he almost talked the pearls of the visual fields. Now, I start with today's session. I will start the basics of the perimetry and understanding of single field analysis printout today. And tomorrow, the next session on 25th, I think, I will be talking about the interpretation and progression analysis. Today's talk includes the basics of the static perimetry, the point patterns, testing strategies, understanding of single field analysis printout, identification of artifacts and non-glaucometer field effects. As you know, today the automated static perimetry is white on white perimetry, static perimetry, which means that the size of the stimulus and the background illumination remain constant, and the brightness of the stimulus is altered to get the retinal sensitivity. So every machine will have brightest light and the dimmest light, and varies from machine to machine. That is why Nayak told you that we can't give the dB value is not the same. So but it varies from machine to machine, because the brightness of the brightest light projected by one perimeter may not be the same with the another perimeter. As you know, by definition, the threshold is the frequency of seeing that at a particular point here, the light intensity is projected, 31 dB light is projected 100 times, and it is appreciated 50% of the time. So any light, if it is shown 100 times and appreciated 50% of the time, and that light intensity is labeled as the threshold to that particular point. So here, the units are used dB units. Normally, the light is measured in terms of ASB units, but it is converted to dB units to express the retinal sensitivity. Why they are converted into dB units? Why not in ASB units, the retinal sensitivity is not expressed? By definition, 0 dB means the brightest light that is projected by the perimeter. There is no attenuation, zero attenuation, 0 dB. You see, this is the brightest light. As the dB value is increasing, the brightness is decreasing. So 10 dB means 10 to the power of 10 times of the maximum. 20 dB means 10 to the power of 2 times of the maximum, which is equal to 100 ASB units. 40 dB means 10 to the power of 4 times of the maximum, 1 ASB unit. So as the dB is increasing, we are making the light is becoming dim, and the dim light is enough to get the retinal sensitivity. So retinal sensitivity and the dB value, they are directly proportional. Higher the dB value, higher the retinal sensitivity. And here the zero, that means the brightest light projected is not responding. It is responding to the brightest light. If it is not responding even to the brightest light projected by the perimeter, it is an inferior sign appears in front of zero. So it directly proportional. Zero, suppose this absolute scotoma, if it is expressed in terms of ASB units, we have to write 10,000 ASB units, which occupies huge space, and it is inversely proportional to the retinal sensitivity. That is why the retinal sensitivity is expressed in dB units. Every test will have two components to find out the threshold at the particular point. Where we test, that is the point pattern, how we test with the testing strategy. First, I will talk about the testing strategy. We have the Walder strategies, full threshold and fast track. Because it is taking long time, in order to save the time and without compromising the quality of the test, the newer strategies came into existence, the Swedish interactive algorithms, the SETA standard, which take the 50% time of the full threshold without compromising the quality of the test, and SETA fast, which takes 50% time of the fast pack. So almost now we are doing SETA standard and SETA fast, replace it completely, full threshold and fast pack. When we want to know the depth of the field effect, you go for Sethastein, right? For all neurological cases where the for diagnosing the case by the pattern of the field effect, you go for Sethafast. Where we don't want the depth of the field effect. Or any patient, older patient who cannot concentrate the test for a longer time, you can straight away go for Sethafast. Coming to the point patterns. Originally, the point patterns started with dash one. The dash 130, when that is the area, dash one in the points, one set of points, they lie on horizontal and vertical axis. And the distance between point to point is 6 degrees. Therefore, there is a huge bare area in the 6 degree in the center. Because of that, it is completely replaced by dash two. Dash two, there are no points on horizontal and vertical axis. That is the difference between dash one and dash two. No points on horizontal and vertical axis. Now, the point patterns, what we use in glaucoma, pyometry, again, the point patterns, they differ from machine to machine. So whatever the machine you have, you please go in detail regard to know the point patterns. Whenever you study the point pattern, always study in which area it is distributed, how many points are there, what is the relation between the point and horizontal and vertical axis, what is the distance between point to point, and what is the distance between the axis and the point, and what is the bare area. These are the points, whatever the point pattern of any mission, you please study on these settings. Now, in Humphrey, we got point patterns 24-2, 30-2, 10-2, and MACLAB program. These are the point patterns what we use to detect in glaucoma. Coming to the point pattern 30-2. Dash 2 means no points on horizontal and vertical axis, and it is a 30-degree area, center being the fovea, and the distance between point to point is 6 degrees, and the distance between point and the axis 3 degrees, and there is a 3-degree bare area in the 30-2. And there are 76 points distributed in 30-2. And coming to the 24-2, 24-2 is nothing but the subset of 30-2, where the outer 22 points are eliminated. They are not there, keeping the two nasal points. So 76 minus 22, we have 54 points in 24-2, and the remaining no points on horizontal and vertical axis, distance between point to point is 6 degrees, and a bare area of 3 degrees. So they are identical points. The subset of 24-2 is nothing but the subset of 30-2. If you study, this is the eliminated, and we have the 16 points within the 10-degree circle area. Normally, this is a 10-degree circle. Within the 10-degree circle, there are 8 points. And these 4 points are also included because they are from 9-degree circle points. Just outside, that is why we use the word 10-degree circle area, where there are 16 points within the 10-degree circle area. And you have to see always the retinal sensitivity of these 10 points, 16 points. And if there is a gross reduction in these 16 points, we have to repeat the test with 10-2. So if you see the 10-degree circle area, not only there is a huge bare area of 3 degrees, there is a huge bare area between 3 degree and 9 degree. These are all, suppose if glaucoma starts within the 10 degrees, within these areas, it is likely to be missed in 24-2 and 30-2. And because we are not going to test up to fixation, even though it gives impression, you see that the printout of 24-2, it gives the impression as if we are getting up to testing up to fixation, but we are not testing up to fixation. These out of this point corresponds to this point. So never comment a foveal split from 24-2 or 30-2. Because there is a huge bare area, the Humphrey introduced new point patterns, 24-2C Sethafaster, 10 points are added. Like this, still please remember that even in the 24-2C point setup, faster point pattern, there are no points within the 3 degree circle. And this 24-2C is not the replacement for 10-2. it only increases the indication to repeat the test with 10-2. So take, this is the 10-2, 10 stands for the 10 degree circle area and no points on horizontal and vertical axis. The point to point distance is 2 degrees and the point to the axis is 1 degree. So we are almost testing the up to fixation. And this is the macular program. The macular program is nothing but 10-2, where the outer three set of points are all indented, and the points within the 3 degree circle, 16 points of 10-2, is the macular program. And this macular program we use in a very advanced case of glaucoma, where the patient cannot do even the 10-2. We used to repeat the test to know the foveal split with size 5, macular program with size 5. And anyway, anytime, normally when you suspect glaucoma, you always start doing the test either with 24-2. And if there is an indication for 10-2, then we will repeat the 10-2. So if you see, this is the 10 degree area, which is having 16 points. And this is the 10-2 program. And you see, all these 12 points are eliminated. They are not there in the 10-2, these points. Thinking that already these points are tested in 24-2. Only the points on 3 degree circle, they are tested both in 24-2 and 10-2. So if you see the combined, if you repeat the test for 24-2 and 10-2 within the 10 degree area, the 12 points which are tested in 24-2 and the 68 points of 10-2, totally they will become 80 points, out of which the points on the 3 degree circle, these 4 points are tested both in 24-2 and 10-2. So totally in 80 points are being tested in the 10 degree circle area when you combine the test 24-2 and 10-2. So now that is about the point pattern. Now you know about the strategy, you know about the point pattern, and you should know about the field analyzer also. Any field analyzer, these the basics will be there. The normative data is stored in the field analyzer. Normative data for each age group, for each strategy, for each point pattern, the normative data is stored. And the change parameters, you can change the parameters, point patterns, whatever the point pattern you want, you can say, and strategy you can change. And fixation target, usually there will be fixation target, central fixation, small diamond and big diamond, and you can change even the size of the stimulus. So you should know about the fixation targets. Normally it is the central fixation, it is a small, and this is the small diamond and this is the big diamond. Normally we always fix the central fixation, but in special situations like in advanced glaucomas or macular disorders, we go for a small diamond or a big diamond. Or when the patient is doing a high fixation losses, then we change the small fixation to the big diamond or small diamond. And most important is blind spot is located. Whatever the fixation center you fix, central fixation, the mission locates the blind spot according to the fixation. If you say central fixation is written in the field analyzer, the patient must see the central fixation only. Otherwise, the blind spot location will be wrongly located and you will get 100% fixation losses. Then coming to the size 5 and size 3. Normally, we always do the test with size 3. And size 5 is almost 16 times bigger than the size 3. And size 3 is almost the size of the artery. And the 16 times bigger is the size 5. Size 5, I already told, we do the test with macular program in advanced case of glaucoma. And regarding the foveal sensitivity, you should always ask, I want the foveal sensitivity on. You please keep the foveal sensitivity on in every test. And ask, and in the foveal sensitivity testing, the light falls within the small diamond. So tell to the patient, the light appears within the small diamond and the patient will do, and the foveal sensitivity will measure it in hardly a few seconds. and all, then you give a pass and correlate the visual acuity and the foveal sensitivity. If they correlate the foveal sensitivity and visual acuity, it means that the patient understood the test, how he has to do, and what the refractive error correction that is given is correct. Then proceed with the test. So basically, you should know what are the indications, what for you are asking the fields. You are asking in a glaucoma suspect or established case of glaucoma or in advanced case of glaucoma, or you are asking for neurological optic nerve disorders, inflammatory or vascular, and CNS lesion impacts or pituitary tumors, or if you are asking for drug toxicity, chloroquine or recombinant or macular disorders. Why? Because keeping these indications, so suppose you are asking for drug toxicity, you will ask for 10-2 with a fast strategy. Suppose you are asking macular disorders, you may fix a big diamond or a small diamond. And when you are thinking of neurological case, you can straight away go for Seta fast. In a glaucoma suspect, you always should go for Seta standard. And in advanced case, you can go even for, because you cannot do the test properly, you can go for Seta fast. So you must have an idea for what condition you are going asking for the test. So any test, you must have a forma of the visual field testing of your own, which is the patient data and the test data. And this pro forma, you have to complete in detail and meticulously and accurately. Name of the patient, age of the patient should be perfectly written, because all the age match, the normative data is compared with the measured retinal sensitivity. And the analysis, stat pack analysis is completely dependent on age. So you have to enter the age perfectly. Refractive error correction must be perfect. It should correlate with foveal sensitivity, and visual acuity must be 10. And size of the pupil is very, very important. Normal size, usually the normal size is 3 to 3.5 millimeters. Less than 2.5 millimeters, we say small pupil. And 3.5 millimeters greater is big pupil, dilated pupil. And this is the patient data and the test data, which includes the point, test point pattern. What point pattern you want? The 24-2, 10-2, 30-2 or macular program, and strategy, set of standard or set of fast. Normally, always it is central fixation. In special situations, only they change it to small diamond and big diamond. And normally, it is always size 3. It may be changed to size 5 in special situations, already told. Now, the patient, now you understood the test, going to do, explain. I always say that every ophthalmologist must undergo the test once. Once you undergo the test, you will be knowing the difficulties during the test, what you encounter. Then you will become a better teacher to train your staff or to tell to the patient and explain the patient and take enough time, explain the patient how he should do the test, how he should sit, what is the, how the forehead should be there, how is the chin and the trial set, and use always the trial lenses without the rim to avoid rim artifacts. And so take enough time and ask the patient to keep the head without tilt throughout the test and start the test with the foveal sensitivity. Once the foveal sensitivity is complete, you give a pass and see, correlate with the foveal sensitivity and visual acuity. If they correspond to each other, then ask the patient, the light will be off and the central fixation light will be on, and ask the patient to shift his gaze, the fixation to the small light, to the central fixation. So that is very important. If the patient continues to see the small, this area only, and the blind spot will be located according to the central fixation, because we have to read central fixation as the fixation target and blind spot location accordingly. And if the patient sees this instead of not shifting to fixation center, the blind spot fixation losses will come 100% wrong. Now, the patient did the test. This is the measured retinal sensitivity. It is the raw data. And now this raw data will be analyzed with an armature data and the single pin analysis printout will come. If there is no armature data available, take for example with size 5 and the custom test, where there is no armature data, a 311 printout will come with a grayscale and the raw data and the reference values, because the machine knows approximately what is the normal sensitivity in that area. And according to that, even though there is no normative data, it will give the reference values. Because already the machine had the information around this place, this is the normal sensitivity according to that age, and approximately it gives the reference value. This is the reference value. And this is the 3-in-1 printout. Because there is no normative data available, this printout will come. So this is the single field analysis printout. Today, I will be talking about this understanding of the single field analysis printout. Next session, I will be talking interpretation. So I always say that understanding of the single field analysis printout is different and interpretation is different. Here, as Nayak already told, nothing is written unnecessarily. It is everything, each word, each line, each capital, each letter will have a sense because it is meticulously planned. So you have to read entire visual field without missing anything. So for better understanding, it is divided into zones. Zone 1, the patient data, test data. Zone 2, reliability data. Zone 3, raw data. This is the measured retinal sensitivity. And this is the grayscale. And this is the total deviation numerical plot, total deviation probability plot, pattern deviation numerical plot, pattern deviation probability plot, global indices, which contains mean deviation index, pattern standard deviation, and visual field index. And zone 10 is the glaucoma hemifield test. And zone 11 is the gaze track. Now we start with the zone 1, patient data tested. Zone 1 is nothing but our proforma. So see what they confirm, the proforma and this zone, the patient data, test data correlate with each other. This is nothing but you confirm exactly entered or not. Then comes the reliability data. How the page there, we have two components. We have actually fixation losses, false positives and false negatives. If you divide the reliability data into two groups, how he is fixing, that is the fixation losses, how he is doing false positives and false negatives. So reliability data. Now we talk with the how the performance, how the false positives and false negatives. We start with positive. Out of all these things, most important index is the of the reliability indices is the false positive errors. Normally, when we are collected the normative data, if fixation losses, false positives, false negatives, they are accepted up to 33%. But what is the normal range one has to accept? Because the false positives beyond 15%, take it for 15%, this is associated with the compromised test results and you have to repeat. What is meant by false positive errors? The patient normally is trigger happy. The most important, normally the false positive response error scores, the measures of the tendency of the patients to press the response button, even when there is no stimulus, has actually been seen, trigger happy. There is no stimulus and the machine produces the sound and he thinks that the light came and he presses it. Or the tested area is retested with the dimmer light for which the patient should not respond, he responds. So his trigger happy. That is the false positive. And take it for granted, if it is more than 15%, you have to repeat the test. It should not even be more than 20%. But fixation losses, you can allow it up to 20%. The false negative errors, we can accept up to 20%. What is meant by false negative? The tested area is retested with a brighter light for which the patient should respond, but the patient won't respond. That means he is not responding. He is either fatigued or sometimes you may not understand, you understood the test properly, and it indicates that even in advanced case of glaucomas, we see quite frequently high rate of false negatives. So it can be accepted up to 20%. And coming to the fixation losses. The fixation losses, how it measures the gaze, how is the patient is they fixing the central, the fixation target. It is of two methods, blind spot method and gaze tracking. Blind spot method means the according to the fixation target, the blind spot is located by the mission. And occasionally, during the test, the light falls on the blind spot and the patient should not respond. And if he's responding, means he's moving the eye. Suppose if I say that 3 by 20, that means 20 times the light fell on the blind spot and 3 times he responded. 0 by 15, 15 times the light fell on the blind spot and the patient did not respond. That is the fixation loss. Coming to the gaze tracking. See, this is the patent of the Humphrey field analyzer. It measures the pupillary center and the cardinal reflex. They must coincide. And it is not affected by head tilt. That is very important. Suppose the head tilt will be affected in the blind spot fixation method. And suppose during the test, if the patient bends his head, we will get 100% fixation losses. Will get. Whereas in head tilt will not be affected by the pupillary center and the cardinal reflex, the gaze. And you see, only when the eyeball moves only, they will be going apart. And once in the bar, there is a movement of the eyeball, there will be upper spike. And if the gaze is perfect, it is a straight line. And if there is a blink, that means absence of the pupil or the corneal reflex, there is a downward stroke, that is the blink. Always, you should always see, correlate the fixation losses by blind spot method, whatever you are getting, with gaze. Suppose there is the patient, we are getting 100%. Take for example, we'll get the, usually it happens in a single eye, when you are testing for a single one-eyed people and you are testing for left eye, by mistake, in the pro forma, they may enter as a right eye and the blind spot will be located to the right eye and you are testing the left eye and you will get 100% fixation losses. But if you see, if the patient may be 100% fixing properly and the gaze track will be normal. So if the gaze track and the fixation losses, they don't correlate, something is going wrong. Somewhere the patient, we have not written the eye properly, or the patient might have even the head tilt, which is not affected to the gaze tracking and affected by the fixation target by the blind spot. So you have to correlate the fixation losses and the gaze tracking. So now we know how the patient did the test by false positives, false negatives, and fixation losses and gaze tracking. These are the four parameters how the patient did the test. Now coming to this raw data, this is the measured retinal sensitivity, and this is the zone 3. Always I say, during understanding, you should always start with the raw data because everything is derived from the raw data. So we have to see the raw data before going into the other zones. Because we know grossly, because you know the retinal sensitivity, they're all the numerical values in dB units. Higher the value, higher the retinal sensitivity. Lower the value, lower the retinal sensitivity. Normally, the retinal sensitivity is highest at the fovea. As Nayak already told, usually it cannot be beyond 40, 41, 42. Beyond, if it is coming 44, 45, it's trigger happy. It's a false high, false positive. Normally, the highest at the fovea, and as goes to the periphery, decreases. This is the Hill of vision. Normal to data means this is the normal values. Any point lies on the hill, it is normal. And if you see a brightest light not responding to the brightest light, an inferior sign appears in front of zero. Suppose if you see an inferior sign in front of any numerical value, it indicates that bulb is becoming dim. So if you see an inferior sign in front of any numerical value other than zero, it indicates that the bulb is becoming dim and you have to replace the bulb. And always concentrate the 16 points within 10 degree circle of 24-30-2. If there is a gross reduction, and then we have to repeat the test with 10-2. Here, there is an absolute scotoma, and we have to repeat the test with 10-2. And so, this is the raw data, numerical values. Now, this raw data is now converted into the grayscale. That is the gray, zone 4. This is just, this is only by the values. Higher the value, better the shade, and lower the value, darker the shade. And if there is an absolute scotoma, the darkest. So a zero in a raw data is absolute scotoma. You please remember, an inferior sign in front of a zero is an absolute scotoma. Zero means responding to 10,000 ASV units, brightest light of the particular machine. Not responding, inferior sign appears in front of zero. That is absolute scotoma. A zero in a raw data is absolute scotoma. And it is the darker area. So the grayscale is nothing but the shade format of raw data. The brighter side to the higher values, darker shade to the lower values. And we talk always, we see grayscale in every visual printout. Grayscale is very, very important. We use the grayscale, but it is given least importance because of certain reasons. But there is always a huge value is there for grayscale. The identification of enlargement of the blind spot is better appreciated in the grayscale. It is not better appreciated anywhere. It is better appreciated in the grayscale. Multiformic origin, multicentric origin of glaucoma. Glaucoma can start not at a single place in progress. It can start anywhere. In 2-3 places, it can start. The multicentric origin of glaucoma can be better appreciated in the grayscale. You see, this is not being appreciated in the probability plots. It is better appreciated in the grayscale. Take, for example, this is the patient progression. The progressor, but the progression, depth progression, vertical progression, you see the darkness is increased. And in the probability plots, it is not appreciated. Because I will tell all these things in the progression analysis. So progression, the depth of the increase in depth is better appreciated in the grayscale. So there are a number of advantages even to identify the which side, the temporal side, seeing the blind spot, which eye, the left eye. Yeah, all these things we see, we use without our knowledge. We see a grayscale and identify the temporal half of the field, identify the side of the field, and enlargement of the blind spot, and see. But the most important thing is, see, the central area, the retinal sensitivity is very high in the central area. So the central area is the brightest when compared to the peripheral area. Here, the retinal sensitivity is around 35, 36, and here the retinal sensitivity is around 30. So you should know the central area is very bright. See, using the central area, here the central area is decreasing. So it is actually, there is a loss of retinal sensitivity. So superficial loss of, even there is a loss of retinal sensitivity in this area by 5 dB, 6 dB, still this will have a better shade than this, because this area is around 29. Even a loss of retinal sensitivity more than 6 dB, 7 dB, 8 dB, still you don't appreciate the dimmer area, darker area than this. That is the main drawback where we likely to miss the superficial scotomas that appears within the 10 degree circle. But that will be picked up by probability plots. See, when you compare this and you compare this, if you see just like that, you take it for granted the grayscale is normal. No, the grayscale is not normal. See, this is the normal, the brightness is lost. You have to pick up the loss of brightness in the central area. That is very, very important. And we should know that the location of the blind spot, the location of the blind spot usually between 15 to 12 to 18, the center being 15 degrees, a little below the horizontal axis. That is the normal location of the blind spot. See, the enlargement of the blind spot. Sometimes you may not see the blind spot because the disc may be very small and the machine may not be able to pick up the blind spot. And this is the normal position of the blind spot. You see, sometimes the patient actually did the test without shifting from small diamond to central fixation. That is why the blind spot is located down. And if you see the fixation losses, it will be 100% wrong. So that is all about the grayscale. And now coming to the total deviation numerical plot. This is a total deviation numerical. Total deviation numerical plot is nothing but raw data expressed in terms of deviation from normal value. So it is a deviation plot from the normal to data. How much it is deviated? It is just like the deviation map of the OCT. Whereas raw data is the thickness map. Raw data is the thickness map. And the total deviation numerical plot is the deviation. How much it is deviated from normal to data. It gives you the exact depth of the field effect. How much loss at each point. So this is the measured retinal sensitivity. This is the measured retinal sensitivity. This is the normative data. Normative data is 32. The measured retinal sensitivity is 27. So the loss is 5. So how much it is deviated from the normative data? It is written. So basically, these numerical values, this is the measured retinal sensitivity. I use the three colors. The retinal sensitivity better than normal is given yellow color. It is just like my own, I gave the shades to appreciate the colors, good looking colors. And the green given for the normal color, normal to data. This is normal values. There is no deviation, zero deviation. They lie on the hill of vision. For loss of retinal sensitivity, red is given. So any numerical, any deviation map, the total deviation numerical plot can have three values. They may be better than normal point, there may be no loss of retinal sensitivity point or loss of retinal sensitivity point. Three groups can be there. Or all the points, maybe all may be the loss of retinal sensitivity points without a normal point or better than normal point. But basically, there can be three points, three groups, a point better than normal, a point no loss of retinal sensitivity, point with loss of retinal sensitivity. So a zero in raw data is absolute scotoma. A zero in total deviation numerical plot means there is no deviation, zero deviation. It is normal. The zero in total deviation numerical plot indicates that measured retinal sensitivity and the raw data are same. There is no deviation. It is zero deviation from the raw data. This is the total deviation numerical plot. This is the measured retinal sensitivity, 30. The normal data is 30. So no deviation, zero. The measured retinal sensitivity is 29. The normative data is 33. So there is a loss by 4, minus 4. 33 and 29, there is minus 4. The measured retinal sensitivity is 31. Normative data is 30. But so this is better than normal. No sign. No sign in front of it. Better than normal. 30, it is better than normal. Now you know the total deviation numerical plot can have three groups, better than normal, normal, loss of retinal sensitive points. So we use some words, edge scotomas, edge points. Edge points are nothing but outer set of points. And we use the word seventh best deviation point of total deviation numerical plot. So most important thing is the key point of entire visual field analysis by arranging the deviation points in a chronological order. This is the software that they mean, the minute the total deviation numerical plot is there, software arranges the parts, all the numerical values in a chronological order. The best point being the positive point, better than normal, the highest point. That is the best point. If there is a point in this plot, it will come first. Then comes points without loss of retinal sensitivity. That means points on the hill of vision, zero. Any zeros will be. If there are no, then starts with the loss of retinal sensitivity points. And the least deviated comes first, and the worst point will be the highest deviation. So arranging the numerical, the deviation values in a chronological order. Once they are arranged in a chronological order, the best point is 3, the second best is 1, 3rd, 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th. This is the 7th best deviation point. Then 8th, 9th, 10th line. And this is the worst deviation point. So while this is the how we select the 7th best deviation point, and I will tell you why 7th best is taken into consideration. And while selecting the 7th best deviation point, the outer set points of 30-2 are not considered. So and the only the points of 24-2 only they are considered. Already you are acquainted, you know, about visual fields and all. The outer set of points are not considered while selecting the 7th best deviation point. The outer set points are not considered when we are considering visual field index. Outer set points are not considered in glaucoma hemifield test. Outer set points of 30-2 are not considered in Anderson's criteria. Then, and the outer set points will be tested last. And by the time the patient may get fatigued, and we will get false negative errors and fixation losses. Why to have, when we are not considering outer set points of 30-2 in all these points, in all these key zones, then why to go for 30-2? So naturally, now most of the times, we go for 24-2 instead of 30-2, but in very special occasions, I will let you know when you go for 30-2. And this is about the chronological order and selecting the 7th best point. Now it is very clear what do you mean by 7th best deviation point of TDNP. Arrange in a chronological order, the best to the worst, and then pick up the 7th position point. That becomes the 7th best deviation point of total deviation numerical plot. Now, this is the total deviation numerical plot. Actually, numerical plot can be called as loss of retinal sensitivity plot. But it also giving better points and normal points. We did not use the word retinal sensitivity, loss of retinal sensitivity plot. Otherwise, it is actually basically, it gives you the depth of the field effect at each point. What is the loss of retinal sensitivity at each point? Now, this is the numericals, but you know it is converted into the scotometer form depending upon the p-value. How much commonly it is seen in general population? If it is seen in 5% of the normal population of this value, this symbol is given. And if it is 2% of the normal population, it is given this symbol. If the retinal sensitivity or the loss of retina is seen in 1% of the normal population, this symbol is given. And if it is seen in 1 in 200 of normal population, this symbol is given, black symbol. So a black square in the probability plot is not absolute scotoma. It only indicates that its p-value is less than 0.5%. So you see, 7 is also black square, 8 is also black square, 12 is also black square, 34 is also black square. A black square in the probability plot only tells you that its p-value is less than 0.5%. Never assess to the depth of the field effect from the probability plots. If you want to know the depth of the field effect, you have to see the total deviation numerical plot, how much loss is that at each point. And the better points are not given the p-value. Even the better point is also not commonly seen. But the p-value is not given to the better point. The p-value is only given to the loss of retinal sensitivity points. So never assess the depth from the total deviation probability plot. This is the probability plot. A black square in the probability plot indicates that its p-value is less than 0.5%. Never come, even so, I already told you, it is almost in 24-1, 30-2, by seeing a black square at the then 3-degree point, never comment the four-wheel split unless otherwise you go for 10-2. So we know this is the raw data, is converted to grayscale, it's converted to total deviation numerical plot, and it's converted to Scotobutters form. If there is a field loss, the field loss is now seen. The field loss, what we see in the raw data, it is seen in the grayscale, it is seen in the total deviation numerical plot, it is seen in the total deviation probability plot. So this is the retinal observability defect and correlating with the field defect. So once we know the extent of the field defect is known, the pattern of the field defect is known, and if you see the total deviation and pattern deviation probability plots in a localized scotoma, they are looking similar. Then why the pattern probability plots are created? When we know already the extent of the field effect, the pattern of the field effect is known in the total deviation probability plot itself, then why the pattern deviation probability plots or pattern deviation plots are created? And they are created, but in a localized scotoma, you see they are identical. They are looking similar. Take, for example, the commonest cause of uniform generalized depression is cataract. And the loss of, you already told that, more the loss of retinal sensitivity, more than 8 dB, will have all black squares. If there is a loss of retinal sensitivity in a cataract more than 8 dB, all will be represented by black squares. Now, this patient develops a localized scotoma. How do you appreciate a localized scotoma in a generalized depression? Then this patient develops homonymous hemianopia or bitemporal hemianopia or any AON. How do you appreciate the localized scotoma in a generalized depression? We will require another plot. Take, for example, this patient, a cataract patient, developed a glaucoma. Is the circular defect seen? And that is appreciated, picked up in the raw data is 0. This absolute scotoma is appreciated in the grayscale. This absolute scotoma is appreciated in the total deviation numerical plot as -32. But this is masked in the already -8 is a black square. This the deep scotoma is hidden in the total deviation scotoma. The pattern plot is created. This is another example. Again, this is the nerve fibrillary defect. This is the raw data. We are seeing a localized field effect in the raw data, appreciated in the grayscale, appreciated in the total deviation dot numerical plot, masked in the total deviation probability plot, and this deep scotoma is highlighted in the pattern deviation probability plot. This is the temporal hemianopia. Appreciated in the raw data, appreciated in the grayscale, appreciated in the total deviation of the plot, but masked in the generalized depression and highlighted in the pattern plot. So now it is very clear, when there is a generalized depression, to appreciate if there is any localized scotoma in a generalized depression, to appreciate the localized scotoma in a generalized depression, the probability, the pattern deviation plots are created. Now it is very clear why they are created. Now we should know how they are created. So to create the pattern deviation plot, we have to remove the generalized depression. Then how much generalized depression should be removed from the total deviation plots? Take, for example, these are the three cases of the printout, and X-ray is also, these are localized. And now you see, all the are generalized depressions. But if you see the numerical values, there is a huge difference. Here, the generalized depression started with -10 to -34. Here, then the generalized depression started from -4 to mostly they are, most of the around 7-8, and only along few points have lost. Here, most of the points are almost symmetrical. Here almost the localized area, most of the points are also very low values. Then how much generalized dispersion should be removed? That is the question. Then I told you the key point is arranging in a chronological order, whatever it may be. All the deviation points are arranged in a chronological order. And you pick up any point you like, whether you pick up 7th best or 10th best, you pick up one. Because 7th best, why it is picked up? Because out of 54 points, the 2 points in the blind area removed 52 points. And that means 7 points out of 52 means 15% of the points will become normal. Suppose if you take the this is the 7th best. Now, here the 7th best is 21. Here 7th best is minus 6. Here 7th best is minus 7. Suppose if you add the 7th best point to normal, these points will become normal. Here the 21 is the 7th best. You add 21 to all, so all these points will become without any significant value. If we add plus 6 to all, these points will become normal. If we add plus 7, these points will become normal. And in here, almost in a localized scotoma, most of the points will be around in the 0, 0, there are no deviation values. So 7th best will have a minimal value. Now to come to this one. But this is the uniform generalized depression. You arrange in a chronological order. The 7th best is minus 7. You add plus 7. So see, all points are deviated. Minus 4, minus 6, minus 7, 11 is the deviation point. 7th best point, you take for example, this is the minus 4, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6, minus 6, minus 6, this is minus 7. Green is minus 7, yellows are. Now, if you add the 7th best point to bring to normal, you add to all. When you are bringing the 7th best to the normal left field vision, the first 6 points will become without any significant value. So, take for example, in this thing, you arrange in a chronological order, the 7th best in a chronological order, and you see the Hilliard function and how much it is deviated from the Hilliard function and these points. And you are seeing a localized scotoma in a uniform. If you add 6, so minimum 6 points along with you are bringing the 6th best point to normal, all will become, some will become, the first 6 points will occupy here, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 will occupy above the hill of vision, and the 7th and this point also, they will come to hill of vision. So, in a pattern deviation numerical plot, minimum there will be 6 points will be, 7 points will be without any numerical significant p-value. So a generalized depression is converted into a localized depression. So this is the patient with a cataract I showed you. And once the generalized depression is removed, this is the cataract. I operated this patient. And after operation, if the generalized depression is removed, and you find the localized scotoma. And here we are removing the generalized depression by elevating the retinal sensitivity at each point, and by the 7th deviation point becoming normal, to bring up to hill of vision, it will become normal. So this is the here, whatever it may be, we arrange in a chronological order. And the 7th best position is plus minus 15. Now we add plus 15. When we add plus 15, these first 7 points will become normal. So minimum 7 points will become normal in pattern plot. And always 7th best will be 0. You see, 7th best point always will be 0. So seventh best is converted to the DB value that converts seventh best to zero. That means bringing the seventh deviation point to Gilla prism is added to all the points, and they occupy the first six points will occupy either on the Hill of Vision or above the Hill of Vision without any significant p-value. So, now we came to know when there is a generalized depression, to appreciate the localized scotoma in a generalized depression, pattern deviation probability plots are created. Then, in a localized depression, actually we don't require a pattern plot, but the computer doesn't know anything. The computer, whatever is the situation, the printout, it arranges in a chronological order and converts the pattern total deviation plots to pattern deviation plots. So in a localized scotoma, there you see at the printouts, all these are localized scotomas. And there is hardly, they are localized scotomas, they look similar. Because you see, there are three situations. They're absolutely identical. You see this total deviation probability plot and pattern deviation probability plot, they look 100% symmetrical. You see black square, 100. That means there is no change. If you see the seventh best is already zero. So we don't add anything. Here, 3, 1, 0, 0, 0. Seventh best is already on the Hill of Vision. So we don't add anything. So zero, no addition. So both probability plots look similar. Here, if you see this total deviation plot and a pattern plot, here we are seeing little change. Here more scotomas, little change is there. And if you see the seventh best is -1. So yeah, you added only +1. By adding +1, there will be hardly any change. That is why you don't see any definite change in the probability plots in a localized scotoma. Either seventh best will be either 0 or -1. Sometimes you may find better points. You see, take for example this point. You see the probability plots. Actually, this is having the pattern plot is having more scotomas than the total deviation plot. If you see more scotomas in the pattern deviation plot than the total deviation plot, that indicates the seventh best position is on the plus side. You see, they are arranged in a chronological order. The seventh best is +1. And so, whatever it may be, the +1 is there. You have to bring seventh best to 0 or to the normal Hill of Vision. We add -1. So, instead of elevating, we are actually decreasing. The -1 is added to bring the seventh best position to 0. And along with that, all these things will decrease. So you may find a little more scotomas in the pattern plot than the total deviation plot. If you see more scotomas in the pattern deviation probability plot than the pattern deviation probability plot than the total deviation probability plot, it indicates the seventh best position is, seventh best deviation point is +1. So in a localized scotoma, the seventh best position is either 0 or maybe -1 or +1. So hardly, by already they are nearer to the Hill of Vision. So they won't add anything. So you don't find any difference between the probability plots of pattern plot, total deviation plot, and the pattern plot. Take for example this thing, the fixation losses, false positives are very high. Take for example here. Yeah, almost high, the false positives are there, fixation losses. Once you arrange here, it is almost total deviation numerical plot disease. If this -6 and -1 are not there, all are better points. It is looking, if these two points are not there, it is very difficult to differentiate it from raw data. Because -6 and -1 are there, we can tell that it is a total deviation numerical plot. And the best seventh position is +18. The best seventh position is +18. Now we add -18 to all the points. We arrange in a chronological order. You see, this is the 20, this is the +19, 18, +1, -7. Only two points are loss of retinal sensitive points. And to bring the 7th best is 18. To bring 7th best to the Hill of Vision, minus 18 is added. So all the points are decreased. And you see more scotomas in the pattern plot. So now you understood the raw data, grayscale, the total deviation numerical plot, the gives the depth of the field effect, and total deviation probability plot gives the extent and the pattern of the field effect. When it is a localized scotoma, both probability plots they look similar. And when there is a generalized depression, to know whether this generalized depression is having a scotoma or not, which is already appreciated in the grayscale, already appreciated in the total deviation numerical plot, and it will be appreciated in the pattern plot. If there is no scotoma, you don't see any scotoma here. If you see a uniform loss of retinal symmetry at all the points, and you don't see any scotoma, that means a uniform generalized depression. This is all about the. This is the quantity. Up to now, we arrange. We know the quantitative analysis. This is the actually analysis of the field effect. Quantitative analysis. Where is the location? What is the extent? Whether it is a localized scotoma or a generalized scotoma, if it is a generalized scotoma, whether it is a uniform generalized scotoma, irregular generalized scotoma. So we know the quantitative analysis up to this point. Till now, we do not know, we have not studied exactly what is the depth, exact depth, we have not studied. For that, actually, the qualitative analysis of the field effect, the mean deviation index, pattern standard deviation, and glaucoma, this visual field index came into existence. Now we will understand the global indices, which will have mean deviation index, pattern standard deviation, and visual field index. When there is a loss of retinal sensitivity, always there will be a change in height of field of vision. The loss can be irregular or uniform. There are two components of field of vision. One is the contour, another is height. When the loss is uniform, you don't find the loss is there. So the height of field of vision will decrease, and this is the original height. Change in height of field of vision is the mean deviation index. Change in height of field of vision is the original height and height of the measured retinal sensitivity, and this is the change in height of field, that is the mean deviation index. When there is a loss, but there is a uniform loss, there is no change in contour. No change in contour. Here there is a loss and there is a change in contour. So there are two things. To express the change, loss of retinal sensitivity in terms of change in height, that is mean deviation index, change in contour, that is PhD. PhD is, tells about the contour, irregular loss or a uniform loss. In uniform loss, the contour is smooth and PhD will be non-significant. But when there is a loss, always mean deviation will be, the height of field of vision will be decreased. So we know two indices. One tells about the loss of retinal sensitivity. One tells the contour. Another tells the change in height of field of vision. So change in height of field of vision is the mean deviation index. Mean deviation index is nothing but average of all these points. Loss of retinal sensitivity points, zero, and better points. All are added and divided by 52 points. The points and the blind spots are omitted, and the 52 points, because there are 24-54 and 30-2, it will have 74, and in 10-2, because there are no blind spot, all 68 points. So total, we can combine in all the points divided by the number of points. That gives the mean. That is the mean deviation index. If I say that mean deviation is minus 6, that means all the points are minus 6. That is the understanding of the mean. All the points are minus 6. The center, all they are combined, and some weightage is given to the central points. And calculating, this is the mean deviation. This is the average loss. The mean deviation index gives the average loss. And the total deviation at each point, the loss is there, better points may be there, no loss of significant points they are there, but it is converted into average, it is the mean. So whenever there is a mean, there is still, if I say that mean deviation is minus 6.54 dB, it doesn't give any meaning for you. You don't understand anything. You should know, the minute I say that mean deviation index is minus 6, you can't, you should ask it, where is the field effect? What is the extent of the field effect? Is it a localized field effect? Is it a irregular field effect, uniform generalized field effect, or irregular generalized field effect? Is the point pattern of 30-2, 24-2, 10-2? All these things, factors will have influence to know the mean deviation index. You see, take for example here, it is a very localized scotoma. And having minus 26, minus 9, minus 10, minus 10, minus 9. When it is expressed as a mean, the value is minus 3. So the mean deviation minus 3.84 doesn't tell you the exact depth of the localized field. If it is a localized field effect, it gives underrates. Undervalue comes. And this is the mean deviation. But the contour is irregular. That is why in a very early glaucoma, the loss may be in 3-4 points. When it is distributed and expressed as a mean, the value will be minus 1. That is why the mean deviation index is not included in Anderson's criteria. But the dip will be appreciated and the PSD will be significant. The PSD tells you, here, this is the mean deviation index, gives you low value in a localized scotoma. Take for example, this is the uniform loss. Uniform loss means all the points are average minus 6. It gives you exactly the mean, almost equal to the mean deviation, because uniform loss is the contour. This gives you exact mean deviation index, and in a uniform generalized depression, it is almost equal to the each value of the deviation value. To some extent, in a generalized, all generalized irregular, to some extent, the mean deviation may be corresponding to the all the values here, may be corresponding. Another most important thing is, if I say the mean deviation is minus, take for example, in this case, the mean deviation is minus 6. And in this case, the mean deviation is minus 8. But location is very important. Here, minus 6, and here, minus 8, you see, it is centrally located. In this case, take for example, this mean deviation is minus 5. In 24-2, and here in 10-2, minus 12. The same patient, 10-2. And here, the mean deviation, if I say minus 6, see, the minus 6 in this thing, and minus 5 here, and 10-2 is minus 12. So, by telling you once the mean deviation, you should always ask, you should not comment about mean deviation. So most important is, when I say mean deviation, one should ask. So we mean this, take for example, the mean deviation of 24-2 here, a few points are, take for example, here, the 24-2 and 30-2. If the same patient, the 24-2 mean deviation may be higher than the mean deviation of 30-2, because the outer set of points may be normal and they're divided by 74 points and the value may be less. So the mean deviation is a relative index. It depends on the point pattern and the location, the extent of the field effect, whether it's uniform or irregular generalized. So by telling the mean deviation, you cannot comment unless otherwise you know what is the extent of the field effect, what is the location of the field effect, what is the point pattern of the field effect. We are telling the mean deviation index of 24-2, the mean deviation index of 30-2, the mean deviation index of 10-2. So I say always, never grade glaucoma on the basis of mean deviation. So take for example, I told you -3, but it is the location here, it is actually -8, but we started in the center. It is very dangerous when compared to a glaucoma with a mean deviation of -6. So that is all about the mean deviation. From the mean deviation, you understood that it gives you the average loss of retinal sensitivity, the mean of all the deviation values, but you have to see the location, the extent, and the point patterns to comment on the mean deviation index, because all these things are very, very important to set the target IOP and to for progression analysis. That is why I'm taking so much time to explain what exactly meant by mean deviation index. Now coming into the point patterns. This pattern standard deviation. I told you the PSD. PSD tells about the contour. There is a loss. Still, the PSD will be normal because the contour is smooth. So the index that is developed for the loss of retinal sensitivity, the depth is mean deviation index. The PSD is developed to pick up the contour at the depth. If it is irregular, the PSD will be significant. Take for example, this is a localized scotoma, PSD will be significant. A localized, this cataract, uniform generalized depression, PSD will be non-significant because the contour is smooth. A cataract patient developed glaucoma, again PSD will be significant. So the PSD is an index, represents the dissimilar deviation values of total deviation numerical plot. The total deviation numerical plot contains dissimilar values, then PSD will be significant. If the total deviation numerical plot contains the same values, are almost around the same deviation values, the PSD will be non-significant. This is actually picked up early localized scotoma index. It is an index developed to pick up early localized scotoma. It doesn't tell about the depth of the scotoma. It is not related to the depth of the scotoma. It doesn't carry any sign in front of it. And the value doesn't have any severity of glaucoma. It doesn't tell about the severity of glaucoma. Take, for example, the perimetric definition of uniform generalized depression. There is no almost symmetrical values are there. Then PSD will be. No deviation. Even there is a deviation, if the deviation is around the hill of vision, they are almost the definition of perimetric definition of uniform generalized depression is the deviation points are around the hill of vision. That is the definition of perimetric definition of uniform generalized depression. When there are no much deviation, all symmetrical deviation values after the conversion, if it comes around the hill of vision, or there is no deviation around the hill of vision, the PSD will be non-significant. Take for example, this is the patient, early glaucoma, mean deviation is -8. And you see, this is the deviation values. Here, the deviation values are confined to the dissimilarity, and here the three segments are almost symmetrical, and PSD is 10. Here, the glaucoma progresses. My mean deviation index went into -15 to 0.64. And the similarity is decreased to two quadrants are dissimilar, and the similarity is increased by 14. No sign in front of it, you see, PSD is increased. And still more, the mean deviation is increased. Almost all the deviation values are coming around 30. The dissimilarity is decreasing. That means almost PSD started decreasing. The PSD, as glaucoma progresses, it progresses to a certain extent, and afterwards it starts decreasing. It went up to 10, 14. After 15, it starts decreasing. Usually, it came to 19. I will explain in this thing. This is the early glaucoma. This contour is there. So, mean deviation index will be low, but the PSD will be significant. Now it has dissimilar deviation values. The mean deviation will be more and the PSD will be more. In advanced glaucoma, where almost all the points are around 30, the dissimilarity is lost. The mean deviation will increase and PSD will decrease. So the PhD will tell about the contour, the irregularity, or dissimilar values in the total deviation vector plot. So PhD is an index developed to pick up early localized scotoma. That is why it is introduced in Anderson's criteria. So PhD is very important for early diagnosis of glaucoma. Once glaucoma is diagnosed, there is no role of PhD. Only again the PhD role will come in progression analysis. If there is a, take for example, this is the patient with a localized scotoma. This glaucoma patient develops cataract. There won't be any change in the uniform change. So there will not be any change in PhD. So there is a progress, but no change in PhD. That indicates uniform progression. Take for example, this patient, normal cataract, is a cataract patient is there, and he developed a cataract patient. Here a glaucoma patient developing cataract. Here a cataract patient developing glaucoma. Again, the PhD becomes irregular. PhD will change. Coming from here to here, there won't be any change in PhD. But if he develops glaucoma, the PhD will change. A glaucoma patient developing cataract, there is no change in contour. The contour is like this. The same contour is maintained. So no change in contour. If there is no change in contour with change of loss of retina, with loss of retinal sensitivity, there will be PhD will be there. Without change in contour, if there is a loss, there won't be any change in the PhD. Take for example this patient, cataract patient. The PhD is no sign in front of it. That is very important. PhD doesn't carry any sign in front of it. It's 4. I removed the cataract. So I removed the uniform generalized depression. -8 becomes -4, but there is no change in the PhD. So when there is a uniform generalized depression added or uniform generalized depression is removed, the contour will be changed. When there is no change in contour, there won't be change in PhD. Another patient of cataract, mean deviation is -11. The cataract is removed, it became -5.30. But PhD remained almost constant. Once the generalized depression is removed, but there is no change in contour and no change in PhD. So what is the role of PhD? It tells the diagnosis because it picks up the early localized scotoma, early D, that is Anderson's criteria. The progression with change in PhD, that means if there is a localized progression. There is a progression, the change in mean deviation index without change in PhD. That means indicates uniform generalized depression. Coming to the visual field index. Again, this is developed from the visual field VFI, developed from the pattern deviation numerical plot. It is developed from pattern deviation. Again, the outer set points of 30-2 are eliminated, keeping only the 22 points are eliminated, keeping the 2 nostril points. And actually, it tells you how much the patient had the vision. Take for example, and this calculated from the pattern deviation numerical plot. And the base is actually original values are not taken into consideration. Even the values of less than 0.5, the 5% p value is taken as normal. The p value of 5% is taken normal from their loss of retinal sensitivity. This point have retinal sensitivity of 28. If the patient has to lose entire vision, he has to lose -28. Here the patient lost 13, the -13. Still he had -15. So this -15, he had the vision actually. He can afford to lose another 15 dB. This 15 dB, that means he's having this vision. This vision is converted into 100%. This is the 100% is 28, and this is the patient is having 50 minus 15 by minus 15 by minus 28 into 100. That is the percentage. It calculates up all the points like this, and it expresses the percentage. So visual field index tells you how much percentage of vision the patient is having, and the central points are given more value. And it is easy, very easy to explain to the patient how much vision we had in the previous visit. As you take, for example, in the previous visit, you have 75%. Now the vision you had only 50%. You lost 25%. So it is very easy to explain to the patient. And the visual field index is centrally points are given more value, but that is why they say the quality of vision will be better assessed with visual field index. But still, this visual field index is not calculated in 10-2. Not calculated in 10-2. And because the 24-2 and 30-2, within 3 degrees, there are no points. So central vision, they claim, it tells you more about the central vision. But real sense, because there are no points within 3 degrees, the centrally located central vision coming express the quality of vision may not be true. But the most important, why they gave more importance to the visual field index is, if there is any cataract, the generalized depression is removed by conversion from total deviation to pattern plot. So the cataract effect is removed. Once you take into consideration pattern deviation numerical plot, the cataract of any generalized influence, whether it is on positive side or minus side or plus side, pattern plot, the generalized influence is removed and gives you the plot without effect of cataract. That is why the more value is given to the visual field index. So visual field index gives you the exact percentage of vision is having calculated, because many people will ask how the visual field index is calculated. Here, the original is 28, he can afford to lose 28. Here loss is 13, he can afford to have another 15 loss. So minus 15 by 28 into 100, that is the percentage conversion. That is how the visual field index is calculated. Then comes the glaucoma Hemi field test. This is also a software developed by Humphrey to give you the early diagnosis of glaucoma, because the horizontal axis, the upper retina and the lower retina, they are divided into zones, 5 zones, and mirror images down. And the retinal sensitivity of these points are compared with the mirror image zone of the lower point. And if there is a gross difference, then it is labeled as borderline, outside normal limit, abnormally low sensitive, abnormal high sensitive, and nothing is there, all these things fit into, then it comes within normal limits. Again, while calculating, the outer set of points of 30-2 are not considered in glaucoma Hemi field test. So glaucoma, the outer set of 24-2 are not considered. They may ask in your question, how while selecting the best 7, the outer set of points of 30-2 are not considered. While selecting the visual field index, outer set points of 30-2 are not considered. In glaucoma Hemi field test, outer set points are not considered. Even in Anderson's criteria, the cluster points, outer set points of 30-2 or edge points of 30-2 are not considered. When we are not considering the outer set points in all these situations, then why to go for 30-2? You can go straight away for 24-2. But in situations where we are suspecting glaucoma starting away from fixation around 30 degrees, when you see the neuropapillary defect goes not towards the macula, and if it is going away from the macula and taking a straight route, that means this defect is coming far from the periphery. In those situations, so identification of the neuropapillary defect is not enough. You identify and track the path of the neuropapillary defect. If it is going towards the periphery, that means you have to go for 30-2. That is the only indication of selecting 30-2 instead of 24-2. Otherwise, you straight away are in glaucoma. When you suspect glaucoma, almost the disc looking normal, then you have to go for 30-2. Again, all these things I will tell you when during interpretation. So, This is the printout. By many people you will be asking, is this the full threshold printout? The full threshold I used to take in it is the printout of 2002. And afterwards, almost in, from 2005, 2006 onwards, almost we are now taking SETA standard. And this is the full threshold printout. In full threshold printout, you see, the fixation losses will come, okay, 0 by 24, 24 times the light fall in the blind spot and not responded. But false positives and false negatives are expressive in ratios, not in percentage. So in full threshold, they come in ratios. And in full threshold, the this is the raw data, 10 points will be tested twice. So this is a short-term fluctuation to verify because this area is tested, again retested, and what is the original value and what is the retested value and the difference, how much difference is there. And these 10 points, they consider as a short-term fluctuation. Short-term fluctuation is intra-test. During the same test, the point is tested. If there is no difference, that means almost short-term fluctuation is zero. If there is a difference, the short-term fluctuation they give. Still, the short-term fluctuation also doesn't have any sign in front of it, just like PhD. That is known as long-term fluctuation is inter-test variation. And short-term fluctuation is intra-test variation during the test. And this is the PhD. PhD minus short-term fluctuation is corrected pattern standard deviation, CPHD. People will ask, what is meant by CPHD? What is meant by short-term fluctuation? Short-term fluctuation is intra-test variation. Only it will we will see in a full threshold where 10 points will be tested twice and calculate the short-term fluctuation, doesn't have a value. And that value removing, subtracting from PSD gives you the corrected pattern standard deviation. Take for example, this is the 10-2 printout. The 10-2 printout will not have a blind spot. And it doesn't have Brakoma-Emi field test, and it doesn't have visual field index. And if you observe, the 10-2 will not have a black square. The p-value 0.5% is not calculated in 10-2. So you don't see the black square in the 10-2 printout. It is only calculated up to p-value less than 1%. How to identify, we decide when there is no blind spot? The only way of identifying the side of the fuchsia, the right eye and left eye, in a 10-2 printout is only by seeing here. Only it is the right eye. Otherwise, it is just impossible to identify to which eye it belongs. Now, coming to the interpretation part, today I will be talking about artifacts and non-glaucomatous field effects. Most important thing is never interpret visual field in isolation. You can interpret the field, but never tell the diagnosis. If anybody wants the diagnosis, you tell that I want to see the fundus. Without fundus picture, never tell the diagnosis. Take for example, this is the medullated nerve fiber. See, medullated nerve fiber gives the response, the rectus scotomas. The rectus scotoma. Okay. And if the fundus is not seen, it's almost looking like a lower arcade scotoma starting from the nostril cap. You may be mistaken to tell as the glaucoma field effect. So even without asking, without showing the field effect, if anybody asks, you describe the field. Never tell the diagnosis. Tomorrow I will be telling how to interpret, how to describe the field. And the role of disc evaluation, you see, this is the tilted disc. The tilted disc will have field effect like this. If you miss the tilted disc, and you may label as glaucoma field effect. So never tell the, you only describe the field, never tell the diagnosis. Is the raw data is having. Even OCT is giving the data. This is the pale disc. Actually, the fundus examination, actually it gave me more pallor, and the visual acuity is also not corresponding to the fundus. When we took the field, see bitemporal hemianopia, regarding. See, the discipline. Whenever you see this is the whenever the disc parallel exceeding the cup, disc parallel exceeding the cup, you will always ask for MRI. It's a very, very important, and you will find this patient actually is having glaucoma. This patient is having glaucoma, and PI was done elsewhere, and treating as well because PI is done, we are on treatment, and nobody picked up the disc pallor exceeding the cup. Once he had the, picked up this finding and MRI, you see, a glaucoma patient may develop once initially, he may not be having the tumor. Maybe a PI and is on treatment. Later, he might have developed at a PI in a narrow angle when the disc is normal. PI may, might have been done and the patient developed later the brain tumor. And when the disc pallor exceeding the cup, don't hesitate to ask for MRI. Is the AON and asking for hemiopic field effect, the altitudinal field effect. Whenever I told you, when there is a neurological case, you can straight away go for setafast. Setafast instead of, you need not go for setastandard. Strategy C, I wrote here, setafast. You can straight away go for setafast in a neurological case. So the identification of non-glaucomatous field effects and now identification of artifacts. The artifacts are very, most important is identification artifact is a biggest art. Only thing is you should be getting confidence. When you are very confident only, you will be knowing, will be picking up the artifacts. So you have to acquire the strong knowledge. The minute you see, you should know that it's an artifact. You see what are the causes of, this is the Humphrey field analyzer. It first measures the, so normally after seeing the visual acuity and the foveal sensitivity they correlate, if they give a pass, if they don't correlate, then check whether the refractive error is correct or not given, or the patient understood the test or not. The test I see, so I did somewhere 2011, but they did not give the pass. They proceeded with the test. Visual acuity is 6.6 and the foveal sensitivity is 28, and they should have checked whether we have given the correct. They did not check and proceeded. You see, this is the generalized depression. When they came to me, I know this patient is having 6.6 vision. How he can have a foveal sensitivity 28 and the refractive error correction -7 is given. And you see, this is here. So refractive error correction can cause a generalized depression. Then what is the effect of the pupil size? This is a lot of discussion going on in the mini seminars. What should be the pupil size? Normally, the pupil size should be around 3 to 3.5, the normal size. And we do the fields. And the pupil size is less than 2.5, that is a small pupil. And more than 3.5, 4, 5, 6, that is a dilated pupil. So what is the effect of the pupil on the visual field? Definitely, there will be effect. But because the normative data collected is the size 3.5 pupil size. You see the visibility of the stimulus mainly depends heavily on contrast. This brightness of the stimulus and the background illumination is not affected. But when the more light entered, the contrast, the light brightness and the background illumination, they will be changed in proportion. So it won't affect the contrast. But the more light is entering, it may affect the retinal adaptation or optical properties of the lens, the nuclear sclerosis. It will have an impact. But usually what we see is the mean deviation becomes better by 1 or 2 dB. Just like false negatives. So how much 2%, 3% false negative or 5% false negatives, how it impact affects the visual field. In same way, the pupil dilated pupil also will have an effect. But when but it affects them because it affects the generalized effect. So you consider what is the foveal sensitivity. what is the mean deviation index of TDNP. It is a new term what I use, the corrected mean deviation. What is meant by corrected mean deviation? What is the mean deviation of pattern? The mean deviation is always total deviation numerical plot. Then what is the mean deviation of pattern deviation numerical plot? Can you tell the what is the mean deviation of pattern deviation numerical plot? Then you see what is the seventh best deviation value. If you see the seventh deviation value, if we add plus 2 to all the points, that means the mean deviation minus 2, minus 2 dB, that gives you the mean deviation index of pattern deviation numerical plot. If the mean deviation is 15 and seventh best deviation is 7, that means the mean deviation of pattern deviation numerical plot is minus 8. So a cataract, say, take for example, the cataract will have an effect of 7 dB. Seventh best position, the deviation value is 7. The mean deviation is 12. If you remove 7, then it becomes 5. The mean deviation value of the pattern deviation numerical value. Then you see the in the size of the people, okay, what is the mean deviation of the total deviation numerical plot? What is the mean deviation of pattern plot? What is the difference between the two? What is the foveal sensitivity than the previous test? What is the foveal sensitivity of the present test? And what is the reliability of the false positives, false negatives, fixation losses? All these things you have to consider, and while progression analysis, you have to analyze. So the people will have definitely an effect on the, but because in progression, the GPA, because GPA is calculated from visual field index. Visual field index is derived from pattern deviation numerical plot. So when the GPA will not, the people size will not affect grossly on GPA, because the visual field index based, GPA is in visual field index based progression analysis. So it won't affect the progression analysis, even the people size, to that extent, more than the event analysis. Once we want to event analysis, we assess by mean deviation index of the previous test and the present test. Whereas guided progression analysis will be analyzed on the basis of that visual field index. So it will not be affected much. So the size of the pupil of 2 millimeters, its scotomas are there. And when the pupil is dilated, the scotomas of 30, this is a 30-2, even a scotomas of 30-2 disappear. Once, suppose, take for example, whenever you see a scotoma, you always see whether it's small pupil or high false negatives. Or sometimes you may find a scotomas of the rim. Whenever you see a scotoma, you always see whether it is absolute scotoma or not. Here you see they are all absolute scotomas. They may be ring artifacts also. Once the scotoma is absolute scotoma, they are all covered. It may be small pupil or rim. This patient was taken, small pupil, and not seen the fundus, and labeled as advanced. This thing, once the pupil is dilated, you see the normal. The pilocarpinoid pupil. So not only you always, we say that you always correlate with fundus. No, you should always correlate with the patient. Anterior segment, posterior segment. What is the size of the pupil? Whenever you see a small constricted field, you should always suspect. Whenever you see its scotomas, it is once the false negatives are not there, you should suspect a rim artifact or small pupil. Then artifact due to fixation losses, high fixation losses, false negatives, and false positives. I told you this false positive best. The false positives, the best seventh point. I told you this thing. So the best seventh point is also not commonly seen, and that is why p values are not given. So take for example, if the better sensitivity points are also not commonly seen, but the p value is not given. So the better sensitivity points are points. That is why the plant is not given. So in order to reduce the fixation losses, false positives and false negatives, proper education and repeating the test with strategies will reduce the false positives and false negatives, and the fixation losses can be reduced by changing the target, central target, to small diamond or a big diamond, or by changing the stimulus size. fixation losses. Take, for example, these are three clinical situations where 2 by 16. This can be rectified by better education or changing the set, usually by changing SETA standard to SETA fast, the fixation losses usually can be rectified. Here, 100%, 15 by 15. That means something is wrong. The location of the blind spot might have located wrongly. Usually happens in one-eyed people when we are testing. Usually they write right eye and they will be testing the left eye. And head tilt, that is one reason. Or when the patient not shifted from small diamond to fixation center, that is another one situation. We will get 100% fixation losses. And here, 13 by 18, this can be rectified. It actually is fixing at 18 times, 13 times he moved the eye, 5 times he fixed it properly. By changing the fixation, central fixation to either small diamond or big diamond, it can be rectified. So, eye fixation losses. By educating the patient, they became normal. Eye fixation losses by changing from central fixation to small diamond became normal. The false negatives, in spite of education, in spite of changing the strategies, still they became very high. Only once I changed it to size 5, they became normal. And so that is how we can reduce the fixation losses by false positives and false negatives. And this is actually the dimbal, this patient. And if you see the raw data, there is an inferior sign in front of numerical value 1. Once the bulb is changed, see, this is the difference between, this is the right eye after changing the bulb, this is the left eye with the dim bulb and after changing the bulb. This is a known patient of glaucoma. But you see, this is a grass defect and you see this thing. And this is another patient. See, well done field. 0, 0, 0. Fixation loss is 0 by 22. And it is a percentage. In SETA standard and SETA fast, we get percentage. But in full threshold and fast track, it used to come in ratio. This is also well done field. 0, 0, 0. And if you see the raw data, the inferior sign in front of 2. That means the brightest light, if the brightest light is 0, that means 10,000 days beginnings, that the bulb is functioning accurately. If the bulb is giving somewhere 9,500 or 9,300 or 9,000, see, it appears not in front of 0, it appears in front of a numerical value, 2 here, and after replacing, you see how grass, if in spite of doing the best, sometimes you miss to see the raw data. I always say that you see raw data, some of the always use after the patient data, reliability data, raw data, grayscale, and from the raw data, grayscale came. Take for example, this.
Sir, 24. Sir, kindly wind up because special invitees.
Sorry.
We have to take questions too from the net and everywhere. Okay, sir.
Is the absolute score, 0 in raw data is absolute scotoma, a 0 in total deviation numerical plot is no deviation, is 0, normal value, 0 in total pattern deviation numerical plot corresponds to the 7th best deviation point of. Many people will ask questions, the defect, take for example, the fundus we are seeing a defect here, it is actually with the fovea. And this is the defect here we see. The defect, if it is between the fovea and the disc, is always between fovea and the disc, only up and down. Because while you are rotating, we're seeing the left eye fundus, we hold the left eye field, so it will be rotated, and you see the defect only opposite. Many people will be asking, if I see the defect here, the field defect will be here. It is between the disc and the. Okay, thank you. There is nothing actually. I made some questions, but tomorrow in the next session, I will be talking about the invitation. Thank you for giving the opportunity.
Thank you, sir, for Dr. Meet?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Kindly invite the special invitees for their questions.
Yes,
sir. To sir.
Before that, sir, really we appreciate your heart. The way you have taught our students, I think they will be benefited a lot with this. All these. I have also listening to you, and really it is eye-opener that we have to. It is so depth in the field examination. We were only going superficially till now. So all the students, I will request you to ask whatever question come in your mind. It is a rare opportunity to have that ready. Dr. Meet?
Yes. So the PG examination forum has been specially designed in such a way to allow residents and interested students to interact with the esteemed faculty. Towards that end, if you would like to join the PG examination forum group, you could message your name and college name to Dr. Deepak Mishra, the administrator of the PG examination forum, on his phone number 9415360338. And on that note, we have with us a couple of special invitees for the occasion. I'd just like to take a moment to introduce them to you all. So the special invitees on the panel are myself, Dr. Meet Parikh, Senior Resident, Medical College, Baroda, Gujarat. We also have Dr. Anupriya Kohli, DOMS, RIO, Sitapur, Dr. Vrishal Bansali, Radhabha Khushal Dada Eye Hospital, Dr. Vibha Singh, NDMC, Hindu Rao Hospital, Delhi, Dr. Upasna Ajmani, Resident, RIO, Amritsar, Dr. Pankti R. Shah, Resident, CH Nagri Eye Hospital and Research Institute, Ahmedabad. Now, I'd like to invite all the special invitees, if you have any questions or if you would like to share your views regarding the PG examination forum, to please put forth your views.
Hello. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, Anupriya, yes.
Yeah. Sir, I have a question. Sir, like every glaucoma patient who's coming to our OPD, when should we actually advise the fields for the patient? Like, which field should we go for? 24-2, 30-2, 10-2? How should we actually step up?
Should I answer? Whom the question?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
To me only.
Yes, sir.
When you suspect glaucoma, you ask for fields, no?
Yes,
when
sir.
You are suspecting fields. When you suspect, I told you, you should go for 30-2 or 24-2.
Okay,
and once you suspect, you have to ask for fields. I told you, 30-2, when you are seeing the fundus being normal, almost looking normal, but the IOP is on the higher side, you are suspecting on the basis of IOP, and you have to go for 30-2. When you are seeing an orthobular defect, and you trace the orthobular defect, and if that orthobular defect is going towards the macula, 24, you, whatever it may be, when you suspect glaucoma, you always go for 24-2 or 30-2. Always take the strategy set a standard. And study the 24-2 printout, the within 10 degrees, the 16 points. If there is a glass reduction, even about the single point within the 16 points, you ask for 10-2. And especially the neurofibular effect going towards the fovea. 24-2 gives less information, and 10-2 will give you huge information. So the glaucomas basically, on the basis of the location, they are divided into three. Glaucoma starting within 10 degrees, glaucoma starting outside 10 degrees, glaucoma starting within and outside 10 days. But whatever it may be, once you suspect glaucoma, go for 24-2 or 30-2 and see the central 16 points and take the decision that 10-2. And always go for SETA standard in a suspected case.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Naik, sir, there is one question for you on the our link. Naik, sir, is there?
Okay, if it's not there, I will begin.
Naik, sir. Okay, sir. How you first time counsel the patient? Are your tips to counsel the patient before the first HFA? So that there will be proper understanding between the machine and the patient.
Most important is the patient came to you and you suspected glaucoma. You suspected only glaucoma. And the patient should develop confidence in you. And you can tell that there are two situations clinically, established glaucoma and suspected glaucoma. Suspected glaucoma, you can buy some time to tell that you can have you in the first visit also you need not have the field because he has to develop the confidence in you. Because you are not sure whether the patient, once you tell that you are having glaucoma, I want to do the test, you are not sure that the patient may remain with you or not. The most important any practitioner is the patient should remain with you. Only he should remain when he sees in your eyes, this doctor is taking care of, he is more concerned for me. And in established case of glaucoma, you can be tell that you are having this glaucoma, I am suspecting, and I want to take the field to know to start the treatment. So there is a difference at what stage you are seeing. Most important is you must win the confidence of the patient.
Thank you, sir.
Hey everyone, am I audible to you?
Oh, okay.
Yes, yes, yes.
Thank you so much, sir, to taught us such a difficult topic in such an easy way. My question to you is, in case of advanced glaucoma, if patient came first time, there is no visual field with him or her, then what will be advised, 24-2 or
10-2? No, once you say that clinically advanced, sometimes the disc may be looking, so it is very difficult. Sometimes the disc looks almost not looking like advanced, the field will be very advanced. Sometimes the myope and all, the disc looking not advanced. Whatever it may be, there are two things. You can have straight away 10-2. That the main problem is the 10-2 will have a very good vision. The field will be not that serious. But so if you take 24-2, the almost the total loss with a small island of vision will be 24-2. So always in advanced case, you take both the fields and don't show 10-2 to the patient. Show only 24-2 and you tell that this is the field you are having, and you are only having a small island of vision. Suppose if you say show 10-2, he may be mistaken. Why the doctor is telling I have only few small vision when I had a very bright area in the 10-2. So if the patient won't believe. So 24-2 to explain to the patient, 10-2, slowly you can tell them. So you can have always, you can have both. When the patient can do 24-2, you always take 24-2 and see the indication and ask for 10-2. And only you can go straight away when you are very much acquainted with the patient.
And then okay. We call the patient on second time for the second visual test. What will be the time duration between the second visual field testing?
No. Usually, there are first time you are diagnosing. The patient never went anywhere. First time you are diagnosing. Actually, glaucoma, there are two categories of glaucoma. Glaucoma, just like diabetic retinopathy. In some of the patients, we see the diabetic retinopathy progresses very fast. Some of the patients, they don't. Like this, the glaucoma, there are two types. Very rapidly progressing, slow progressing. So normally what we advise is, initially you take 4 or 5 pills within 1 year or within 1.5 years to know whether it is a fast growing or slow growing. By taking so many pills, the patient may not pay. With payment, he feels. So without payment, you take the food. So that is one aspect, is you are retaining the patient with you. So retaining the patient, glaucoma patient is an art. You do the field freely, 3 times, no problem. He will be with you. Don't charge. Then you can assess that it is a slow progress. And once the patient is stable, you can take the field once in a year. In the next visit he comes, you will examine. You can tell that almost 1 year old, you will take the field if you want. This time I will take, our next visit. Don't force the patient. The patient then he tells, okay, I will go this time. Then otherwise he will tell, sir, I will take the next visit. Don't force. You tell that you require it. Then you see, he will see the sincerity in you. There's no commercial brain in front of behind. Yeah, you give it. Everything is okay. Your tension is okay. You are taking the pill okay. Suppose if the tension is not taking properly, you are appreciating the some change in the taste. You can tell previously. You can show the fundus photograph. This is of your previous fundus photograph, and this is the field. No, I want to know the field to whether to add any drug or not. If the field is same thing, we can continue the same. If there is any change in the field, you have to add another drug. Because your tensions are little on the higher side, you better take the field now or next visit. No problem. 90% of the people, they agree. And 10%, they take the second time.
Thank you.
Sir, can I ask something? Am I audible?
You're audible.
Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much. It was a wonderfully simplified lecture and very interesting. Sir, I would like to ask that which points or how many points should be affected in Tandish 2 to call it a macular split?
No, macular, people want to know macular threat. Normally, the macular program, the word, in the question itself, the answer is there. What is the macular program? Macular program is nothing but the points within the 3 degree circle of Tandish 2. There are 16, how many points are there? 16 points are there in the within 3 degree circle. 12 points are gone. In the macular program, you test those points, and the points, the 1 degree point, the 1 degree circle, and 3 degree circle, and size 5. And the patient, if the patient is able to do the test properly, that means his 4-wheel split is good. If the patient is not able to do properly, that means if not the, at the time of the test, he may be having the 4-wheel split, and now no 4-wheel split. Within 1 week, he may lose the 4-wheel split. So most important thing is always assess that how much degree of patient he had. Only for theory purpose, we save the 4-wheel split and all. For all practical purposes, we don't wait till the affects the 1 degree circle point. If it enters into within 3 degrees, I always take that it is almost practically it is a 4-wheel split. Theoretically, it should involve everything, all the points of one side or one quadrant.
Thank you, sir.
So mostly
sir, there is one more question from Dr. Bansali. He wants to know how you can comment on the reliability of the visual field in cases of glaucoma which develops from the silicone oil.
Okay.
are secondary to the silicon oil. Can you comment on the reliability of? Yes, sir.
These are secondary glaucoma. Secondary glaucoma, the reliability. Yes, secondary glaucoma, we don't, because the secondary glaucoma is treatable. The field effects and all our reliability, we don't consider much on the reliability. We'll ask the, you remove this silicon oil and then we'll do the test. You only go for the, whenever there is a secondary glaucoma, okay. It is only IOP. Secondary glaucoma means IOP raised, not the disc. Secondary glaucoma's definition is secondary to some other cause, the IOP is raised. The secondary glaucoma's diagnosis is increased IOP. Primary glaucoma, PVAG, IOP need not be analyzed. The cause, remove the cause, pressure, whatever it may be. Reliable, we don't wait for reliability. Say that we reduce the pressure.
Sir, in just in brief, can you tell us something about phasing and staging in visual field testing?
But I didn't follow.
Phasing and staging.
Phasing and staging. Staging of visual field. What exactly? What you want to ask?
Like I have read this in some book that in like that is how Humphrey differs from octopus. Like in octopus, they have staging. So
whatever the, you forget about the companies. Take for example, there is a fixation. If the fixation is there, if the eyeball is moving, in octopus it stops the taking the field. It automatically stops. No, whatever that is all software. But once the printout comes, the printout is whatever the information of single field analysis print of M3, the same information will be there in every printout. Every printout will give you, if you take for example glaucoma, it will give you the raw data, the exact retinal sensitivity. It gives you the loss of retinal sensitivity. It gives you the loss of retinal sensitivity in a localized scotoma, and it identifies the localized scotoma in a generalized depression. It gives you average loss. It gives you the dissimilarity, the PSD. Dissimilar names will be different. That's all. The information, whatever information you want to treat or take, for example, our main aim is in glaucoma, the diagnosis, and target IOP and progression analysis. These three things, information we want. For diagnosis, what we want, it is a localized scotoma. How to pick up a localized scotoma at the earliest. That is PSD and glaucoma IME field test. And three scotomas, adjacent scotomas, managed points. Why three? The glaucoma starts at one point and spreads in a direction. That one point, the p-value should be 1%, and the 2 points p-value less 5%. So these three, that lead for a diagnosis. You require a PSD, and a refined PSD is glaucoma field test. Once glaucoma is diagnosed, established, what you want? You want to treat glaucoma, and you want to target IOP. How the target IOP depends? The location of this scotoma, the extent of this scotoma, the direction of this scotoma, and other risk factors. So the location, the extent, the depth, direction. These four factors will give you. Tomorrow I will be in next session, I will be telling all these things. The target IOP, how you set the target IOP in a glaucoma, in established. So in our, once you diagnose glaucoma, your treatment again now starts. How many drugs you want? Where exactly the localized scotoma, what is the depth, what is the extent? What is the direction? What is the location? All these things taken into consideration, and then you start the treatment. Then progression, change in mean deviation, or change in visual field index. Then that is the progression analysis. So whatever this, once you understand the understanding of all these segments, whatever the printout of any mission, you can read just like scientific. What is the fixation loss? What is the false positive? What is the false negative? So So information given by any printout is safe, whether it's something. The software, they talk many things. Forget about all the softwares. Whatever you want. Most important thing is you study the point patterns, where the points are exactly located. What is the bare area around the fixation of the octopus? What is the bare area of the hampery? What is the bare area of upper? Where are the points are located? You know, glaucoma starts usually in these places. How many points are there in that area? What is the distance between points? I told you before, what is the area the points are covering? How many points are there? What is the relation with the axis? What is the bare area? Within 10 degrees, how many points are there? Because we are seeing good number of cases within 10 degrees. How many points are there? Not to miss glaucoma. So what are the indications for repeating the test with tenders? Understanding of single field analysis printout, especially the conversion of pattern total deviation to pattern deviation. So whenever you see anything, what is the foveal sensitivity? What is the mean deviation value? What is the seventh best deviation point? How we identify seventh deviation point of total deviation, pattern deviation? If you see the zero in pattern plot and corresponding point will give you the seventh best deviation point, or the difference between these two. The pattern plot and the total plot, you take one number and the corresponding number, what is the difference between these two? That gives the seventh best deviation point. If you take seventh best deviation point into consideration, minimum 7 points in the pattern plot will become normal. If you take 10th best point, 10 points will become normal in pattern plot. If you take 20th point, 20 points will become normal. Suppose if you take point towards the right, you will be missing the direction of the progression. When the interpretation, I will be telling the interpretation how you should interpret visual fields when it is a glaucoma suspect. In a glaucoma suspect, what is our main aim? Diagnosis, not the treatment. Target IOP is not. First of all, you have to tell whether there is glaucoma or not. For that, the reliability must be 100%. Then Anderson's criteria. Once it is established, reliability is not that criteria. It's established. So only to set the target IOP, you want even up to 20% false negatives, 50% false positives can be taken into consideration. Actually, into comes for fixation losses. Fixation losses 3/50. If no intus are there, you can take it as reliable. 15% false positives, 20% false negatives can be accepted in established case. In a suspected case, false positives, false negatives, fixation losses must be 0, 0, 0. Even 1% false negative will have an impact over the diagnosis. So the more important is at what stage your interpretation depends. No, you understood that you read everything I wrote in my book regarding seventh. I made the news article for the glaucoma newsletter. If you read the newsletter, I think that article will come. I sent to Deepak this thing. Newsletter with 18 pages article I wrote. It's an excellent article. If you read that article, you will understand. Most important thing is you should develop confidence. If I say, what is the mean deviation of pattern deviation plot, numerical plot? It is not written in the visual field printout. The mean deviation will be, because we are adding, how much we are adding while conversion, you remove that from the mean deviation index. That becomes the mean deviation index of pattern deviation plot. The people will talk, okay, people will have effect on the, how much the dilated people were. There is a lot of discussion. Dilated people feel should be taken or not. Okay. Practically, what will happen when the patient comes? And for disc evaluation, we want to have a dilated people. And we cannot ask the patient to come for the field again next visit. So everything should be finished in the single visit. If the patient tells that, I want to take the field. Suppose if you suspect and leave the patient may not come again. So you want to have the field in the same visit with the patient is agreeing. And he cannot sit longer time. So what we do, we when the AC depth is normal, we put the drops and start doing the field. By the time the field is over, the pupil may be dilated by the time, and we do the test. Sometimes the pupil dilates very fast. So dilated pupil field will be taken. But once you have the strong knowledge, just like false positives, false negatives, and you take all these things and you assess the field. Most important is the knowledge. And the, only your brain will see what you know. And the brain won't see what you do not know. So that is very important. The, take for example, the grayscale. I miss the, because I do not know. For many years, I never gave importance within 10 degree circle. Losing the brightness is the difference, not appearing the difference. The central area is very bright in grayscale because the height, the sensitivity is around 35, 36. And when compared to the periphery, the bright is brighter. When it is losing the in a brighter area, brighter sensitivity, it is very difficult to pick up the difference because the periphery and the central, they look similar. Only you know that the brightness is lost, because one of the seminars, when I am seeing the brightness within 10 degree area disappeared, and the field almost looking normal, some shots, and they labeled as perimetric glaucoma because OCT is showing the defect. But actually, the field is also showing the defect. That is not picked up by us. White on white perimetry, 24-2, everybody says that it is normal. There are two things. It is normal to you, or the tested area is normal. The untested area may be, after all, we are testing only 54 points, entire retina. And if glaucoma starts somewhere, and you may likely to be missed. But once you suspect glaucoma, you have to keep suspecting, and you have to repeat after 6 months, and you have to do provocative tests. Most important, you should develop confidence. Once you become confident, the people, you will take more fields. You will ask for more fields, authority will come. And the patient also sees how you are interpreting the field. The confidence levels of interpretation is very high. The patient accepts the next time. You will ask, I will take fields. You understood, no? Everything. What is reliability, total duration, pattern.
Really, we are thankful, Dr. Reddy, to you for taking so much interest in the students and taking all the details very minutely. I hope not only a special invite you, all over India, our PG form students, more than 2,500, must be watching you, listening you, and they will be really benefited by it. At least they will get interested in field examination.
I should be thankful to you because I am very happy to do the PGs.
Yeah, yeah, sir. But definitely, their interest will be created towards this examination. Once they go all through this recording, we send the recording also to all of them so that they can sit at home with ease and they can watch you again.
Next week, I will be talking about interpretation, and you'll enjoy. That is the clinical part. Now, what all we learned today, now we'll apply. During interpretation. That is why during understanding of field, single field analysis printout, raw data should be zone 3. While interpretation, the raw data will come in. So understanding of single field analysis printout is different and interpretation is different. Understanding each zone you have to look for. Take for example, in established case of glaucoma. I don't see glaucoma hemifield test. Because glaucoma field test is to diagnose early stage. It is already established. Why you should look for glaucoma field test? Why you should see for PSD? PSD doesn't have any value because it doesn't give any the severity of glaucoma, depth of glaucoma, it won't give you. So once established, we don't see PSD. If anybody says in established case of glaucoma, mean deviation is -6, the location of the blinds, the field effect is in central area, and it is the extent. And anybody asks, what is PSD? That means he doesn't have knowledge. So established case of glaucoma, If it tells that glaucoma field test is normal, PST will be like this. No, not required. You are, in interpretation, we always see what is required to see. And we don't see what is not required to see. So my interpretation is entirely different. And understanding is entirely. Understanding means each letter in the single field analysis should be appreciated. That is why zone 1, zone 2, zone 3, zone 4. Take for example, grayscale, the age of the patient is wrongly written. Raw data, you should, the entire field need not be ignored. Because the raw data is correct, that patient's raw data, that is correct. Grayscale is correct. Only the statistical analysis age dependent are wrong. Suppose take for example, a 60 year fellow did the test, and it is written 40 years, and the field is normal. You consider the field into taken into consideration, or you want to repeat the test? No, we don't repeat the test because a 60 year old fellow did the test, and is the field normal? Even in comparing with the 40 year old fellow, that means this is the super normal field. So you need not ignore. You need not ignore. You have to see all these things. Is by simply age is written wrong, I don't say. Again, you can see the raw data and the grayscale. Because they're not age dependent. They're directly patient relation or that the particular patient had that raw data. So you should know all these things. When to repeat the test. Because if you are highly knowledgeable, then you will be seeing whatever you know your brain sees. Especially the grayscale. Grayscale, we use grayscale for many things, and in the fields we say that least important zone. No, grayscale gives you huge information. Any more? Should I end?
Yes, sir. So, Mr. Meet, sir, really? We are really, really very thankful to you, and we are eagerly waiting for your next session, which is more important, interpretation. So all of you, next time, next week, to know all the important points what you have learned today, you have to carry it forward now. And told Raman, you are here? Mr. Raman?
Yes, sir.
You want to show video?
Dr. Meet, he will share, sir.
Meet, Mr. Meet, we share the presentation.
Yes.
And today they told you a very new drug, and they want everyone should know about this. And I also want to know that everybody should use this drug because it is really very helpful for us. All the PGs, you will send a report also to you, so that you can again reassess everything what you had listened today. So this phenocaine injection has been introduced by Antoine, first time in India. You can carry forward. Next,
yes, sir. Slide.
This is really very helpful for cataract surgeons. Raman, would you like to speak? I could speak. Yeah, please, Raman, me, second slide. So if it does work, I can go up, carry on. So this phenocaine is a combination of topicamide, phenylnephrine, and local and anesthetic, lignocaine. So it is a combination of the advantage is that it gives very good dilatation, and as soon as you inject the 0.2 ml only, the people get dilated and it remains dilated throughout the surgery. And added advantage is that the local anesthetic effect. So you can do topical anesthesia without any discomfort to the patient and the surgeon. So this is preservative free. 1 ml ampoule is there. You can use 2.2 in per one patient, so you can use in two or three patients on the same ampoule. So we are really thankful to Entor for introducing this drug to all of us. And I have used it and I found it really very useful in my surgery patients. So thank you, Entor, for sponsoring this session. This is almost 2.5 hours. We all are sitting here. So thank you, Meet. You can say and all the special invitees. Meet, you can say thanks to all the special invitees.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Dr. G.R. Reddy, sir. That was the most illuminating session. And as we near towards the end of the session, on behalf of everyone present here, I would like to thank the panelists, Dr. B.K. Nayak, sir, Dr. G.R. Reddy, sir. Thank you for spending your valuable time with us today. Definitely, it was a wonderful session. And on behalf of everyone also, I would like to thank Dr. Deepak Mishra, sir, and Dr. Satanshu Mathur, sir. Your efforts have made this event possible. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Reddy. Thank you, Entor, and Meet, special thanks to you for very well moderating. No, we are not moderating, actually. You were moderating the session. And really, we are thankful to you. You have done a great job.
Thank you, sir, for giving me that opportunity.
And all the special invitees, you all were very wonderful. You are really wonderful, as always. So really, three cheers for the PG Forum. You people are doing a great job. Thank you very much. Thank you, Reddy, sir. Dr. Mr. Raman and entire team, Nikhil, everybody, we are really thankful to you. Raman? Mr. Raman?
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah. So thanks to you and your entire team.
Okay. We'll go offline, sir.
Yeah.
Okay.